I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse through the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more.
I got the horses in the back. Horse stock is attached.
Hello and welcome. That was supposed to look like a horse galloping in, I guess. Yeah, this is a thing. It's sparkling. There's little lights on it. If you can't see, now you can. Howdy, y'all. Let's get started with today's lesson. I'll grab this whiteboard because I'll go ahead and need it. But so today we're gonna start. We're talking about frequencies and how they relate to harmonics, and then changing the length of that tube of air. So first things first, we're talking about frequencies that go with harmonics. So there's we drew pictures last time. You saw how harmonics changed, right? Adding more shapes and all that. So we know what they visually look like, but we didn't talk about the numbers because there's numbers related to them too. So let's see what I mean. So first things first, I'm gonna start with closed and draw the first harmonic, right? So closed looks like this, and the first harmonic, right, looks like this, closed on each end. Simple shape. So we know that's the first harmonic for a closed tube. So this is the first harmonic, what's it also has another name. It's the fundamental frequency. It's the lowest possible frequency that is resonant. It's the lowest possible resonant frequency, the fundamental frequency. It's a frequency, so it has a number associated, right? That there is some frequency that this tube of air wants to vibrate at, and that frequency has a number. So there's a variable associated with this also. The fundamental frequency is written as script F, right, for frequency, and with a little subscript zero for like the zeroth, right, the fundamental frequency, the base one. This might have, say, for some object, like the Slinky that I had, I guess, wants to vibrate naturally at 10 hertz, right? So its fundamental frequency, the lowest possible frequency that it wants to vibrate at, is 10 hertz. So we could call that, I guess, we could say that this is 10 hertz, for example. So what we said before is that the harmonics are just subsequent frequencies that the Slinky, for example, also wants to vibrate at. So we could get it vibrating at this frequency, at first harmonic, or we could increase the frequency and get it vibrating at the second harmonic. It's another frequency that it wants to vibrate at. So let's take a look. So we know that the second harmonic, closed, looks like this. You just draw the same shape twice, right? One, two. So that's what the second harmonic looks like. So this is the second harmonic, but a little bit confusingly, we start off at F0, right? So it is one more than F0, which would be F1. So slightly confusingly, this is the second harmonic, F1, but it's one more than zero, zero being the base. Now, if this is confusing to you, if you have computer science experience, this looks like indexing. But if not, then don't worry about it, because truthfully, we're not really going to be referring to them by their like index value very much. Really, the main important one is just F0 being the fundamental, or like the first harmonic. So that's really all that you have to remember as far as like the numbering goes. So don't worry about that too much if it doesn't make sense. Basically, the harmonic number, second harmonic, F1, third harmonic, F2, fourth harmonic, F3, it's just one less. But again, the F0 is really the only important one to remember, that being the fundamental or the first harmonic. So, back to the second harmonic here. We've got two shapes, right? We had one shape in the fundamental frequency, and we've got two shapes here in the second harmonic. So, I mean, we talked about the relationship between length and wavelength here, but in terms of frequency is how many waves per second are passing a certain point, right? So what we did here in between the first harmonic and the second harmonic, right, we added a whole nother shape. So there's twice as many shapes here passing through a certain point if it's moving through, right? It's I mean, it's pretty straightforward. We did one shape here, and we've got two shapes here. So there's twice as many waves going by per second, right? So the second harmonic, the second frequency, is it occurs at twice the original frequency. And we can see that there's two waves here. So we can write that as a formula here. Well, I'll skip that, and we'll write that at the bottom. So it's twice as many waves per second, meaning it'd be 20 hertz for the second harmonic. And surprise, surprise, I'll draw the third one, I guess. Third harmonic, close, close, looks like this. One, two, three. The third harmonic would be F2. And it's three of the original shapes, right? So there's three times the fundamental frequency waves passing by a point. So we'd get 30 hertz, right? So if you're detecting the pattern here, whatever harmonic number you have, the frequency it occurs, we're close for right now, occurs at the harmonic number time times the fundamental frequency. Third harmonic is three times fundamental. Second harmonic is two times fundamental, right? So we have a pretty easy rule for that. The frequency at some harmonic in minus one, technically, I guess. I'll just write this. This is more user-friendly. The nth harmonic frequency is equal to the number of the harmonic times the fundamental frequency. So whatever harmonic in you're at, if it's the 10th harmonic, you would just take the fundamental, multiply by 10. If it's the 20th harmonic, you just take the fundamental, multiply by 20. Pretty simple and straightforward. At least this one's starting for closed. But I can erase this real quick, and I'll show you open, because it shouldn't be too surprising that open and close have been the same, right? They've reacted the same in all our previous cases, and they do pretty much the same thing here, right? So I won't even write the numbers real quick. I'll just show you what's going on. So we had this fundamental frequency right here, right? That's what the first harmonic looked like, and the second harmonic was just two of those shapes, right? So the same idea goes here, right? We've just got twice as many waves in the same area, twice as many waves per second passing by. So the same rule applies here. If this were 10, this would be 20, and then it would keep going, 30, 40, 50. So the same rule applies here for open as well. Whatever number of harmonic it is, you take the fundamental, multiply by that number. If the fundamental is 1 hertz, then the 100th harmonic would be 100 hertz. Really easy math there. So last but not least, we have clopen. And this one, remember, behaves a little bit differently. So let's see what's going on here. We have closed on this side, open on that side. Our fundamental looks like this, right? Same verbiage here, where first the fundamental frequency is F0, and we'll call it 10 hertz again. Say it happens at 10 hertz. This number here is dependent on whatever material it is, right? Because different materials have different fundamental frequencies. But we're just saying that for this material, it's 10 hertz. So remember that there's no such thing as an even harmonic for clopen, right? It's only odds. So we have to go to the third harmonic, which, closed open, looks like this. One, two, three. So that's the third harmonic. Now, the numbering rule still applies here. Even though this is the next most, or the next closest harmonic, it's the rule still applies, where third harmonic means F2. So it's not F1, even though it's the next closest one. It's still F2, because it's the third harmonic. Again, these numbers here aren't the most important thing to remember. Really what's important is the relationship here. So then we get to the frequency that it's at. And well, it's the third harmonic, so there's three of the original shapes. So it shouldn't be surprising that that rule still applies, that this frequency is still 30 hertz. It's still three times the fundamental in this case. 30 hertz. Because there's three times the shapes before. So that rule doesn't change. In fact, this rule doesn't change either if you're going off of the harmonic number, right? Harmonic number minus one is what this is. But same rule applies here. Whatever the, for the nth harmonic, the frequency for that harmonic is equal to n times the fundamental frequency. Pretty much the same rule for all cases, right? And it's pretty straightforward. You just take the number of the harmonic, multiply times the fundamental. Whatever the fundamental might be, right? They're not always going to be 10. I was just using that because it's an easy number to multiply. So yeah, that's really all that it is with the frequencies. It's not complicated. I just didn't want to throw another piece of information into that previous video because I felt like it could have been kind of confusing if I was throwing all of these things at you at once. So I put this at the start of the next lesson because I thought that would keep things a little clearer. All right, so that brings us to the portion with the straws. Now, if you wanted to go grab some, you just need two plastic straws and some scissors. That's all you need. So I'll give you a moment. Go grab them. Pause and grab them if you want. Okay. So if you've got your straws, what you're going to do first is take your scissors and you need to cut like a little V pattern in them. So you'll snip the side like this right here and then the other side to make a little V. Like that. And you're going to do that on both of them. Make a little V. So you've got two with V's. Now what you're going to do is you're going to take one, you're going to leave one the same length, and then the other one you're going to cut in half so that it's shorter. You should have a long one and a short one. Now what you've made is actually a couple of musical instruments. And they're of different lengths. And so we're going to see what happens to the pitch of the note that I will play with the longer straw versus the shorter straw. So these things can be a little bit tricky to get playing. You kind of have to pinch them with your lips, like right here, and then you're just blowing to get these little, this is a little reed that we've made, to get that vibrating. So let me see how difficult this is for me to get started. Right? I've got practice on this one. So that's the note. We got... That's the long straw. Now, the short straw. These ones are often a little trickier. That's really loud. So... I think you've got the idea. So what's our first question with the straw is, what's the relationship between the length, the pitch, and the frequency of the wave, right? So which one had a lower frequency? The longer straw, right? The longer straw had a lower pitched sound and therefore a lower frequency wave, right? Because frequency and pitch are related. The lower the frequency, the lower the pitch. So this made a lower pitched noise and therefore had a lower pitched sound traveling through it. Or a lower pitched wave, sound wave traveling through it. So that's kind of, that should be intuitive if you've played a musical instrument. If you are, say, taking a guitar and trying to play a higher note, right, you would hold down the string closer, you would make the string shorter effectively, you're holding down a note here. Or if you're playing a wind instrument, if you hold down the bottom holes and the air is coming out the top, then it plays a higher pitched noise. Or something like that, I don't know. That makes sense to me at least. So The shorter the length of the air column or the tube or whatever it is, then the higher the pitch. So let's see what's going on there. I'm going to draw both of the little straws here, and we'll see the difference. So on the left here, I've got the long straw. It's a straw. It's open. And on the right here, I've got the short straw, half the length right here. So this might not actually be the case, but we're going to imagine that we were playing the fundamental frequency in each, the first harmonic in each of these. So I'm going to draw the first harmonic in both tubes. That would look like this for the long one right here, and this for the short one right here, right? That's the fundamental frequency for each. Now, notice when we had the previous rule, right? This is half a wave, right? It starts here and only goes halfway. It doesn't come back. So it's half a wave in each of these. And the formula that we had was the length is equal to half the wavelength, right? So the wavelength is dependent on the length of the straw. Notice that with the shorter straw here, the wavelength is shorter, right? The wavelength is shorter here in the shorter straw. And if the sound is the sound travels through air at a certain speed, right? If the sound is traveling at the same speed, the one that has the shorter wavelength, the smaller wave, has a higher frequency because there's more small waves passing by a certain point, right? For a reminder of the speed of a wave formula that we wrote on, we're going to use this in a second. The speed of a wave is equal to wavelength times frequency, right? So if we're looking for frequency, I'll rearrange this real quick. If we're looking for frequency, it would be speed divided by wavelength. And so if sound is traveling at the same speed, then the smaller our wavelength is, the larger our frequency is. And it makes sense if there's a small itty-bitty wave moving at the same speed as a big long wave, the frequency of the small wave, there are going to be more waves passing by a certain point if the wavelength is smaller. So that I feel like that makes sense. And that's what's going on here. The wavelength is shorter in the shorter straw, so it makes a higher pitched noise because the frequency is higher. Wow, neat. And feel free to make these and annoy your family if you've got plastic straws around. Your parents might not keep straws around anymore if you're doing that, but nothing gained, nothing lost, whatever. All right, or just grab one from a restaurant whenever you can next get one from a restaurant, I guess. So we've got a couple of example problems to use the stuff that we have been talking about over the past couple of lessons. So let's take a look at number one. So our first problem says a standing wave is created in a column of air inside of a tube that is open on both ends. So it's open. The wave travels at 340 meters per second. That's the speed of sound, roughly. And the length of the tube is 0.25 meters. What is the fundamental frequency of the wave? So we're looking for fundamental frequency, and we've got a speed the wave is going at and the length of the tube. So we're going to need to use the speed formula. We're given speed, we're looking for frequency. So I'm going to write this real quick, and we're going to look at what we're missing. So speed is equal to wavelength times frequency, and we're looking for frequency, but we're looking for the fundamental frequency. We obviously have speed here with 340 meters per second. And we also have the length of the tube, the air column moving in. So the length is 0.25 meters. So what we did in the previous lesson is we could figure out the wavelength if we knew which harmonic it was, right? So this one is the fundamental frequency. It's F0, our first harmonic. So the formula that we came up with before was that the wavelength is equal to 2 divided by the number of the harmonic times the length of the tube, right? That was our know-all formula, right? So in this case, we're looking for what is the fundamental frequency. So we're looking at the first harmonic, right? So N equals 1, meaning that wavelength is equal to 2L. Well, we can figure out wavelength, right? Because we know the length, L. So our length, L, plug in here, is equal to 0.25 meters, right? So our wavelength is equal to half a meter, 0.5 meters. So we know our wavelength. And, in fact, we actually know our speed. So we're already ready to go back to the first equation and solve. So our speed is 340 meters per second. Our wavelength is 0.5 meters. And we can solve for frequency. In this case, it's our fundamental frequency, right? Because we used our first harmonic relationship here in this formula. So we can we have a half here. We just divide by half or multiply by 2. I was about to grab my calculator, then I realized what math I was doing. So our frequency here is equal to 2 times 340, which is 680 hertz. Right? That's frequency units. So it is 680 hertz, which in your case, actually, I don't have yours here. Yeah, 680 hertz. Boom. Pretty easy. It's just, it might not have sounded intuitive. We're trying kind of pulling two things together, right? So we had to do this relationship here from the previous lesson to figure out the wavelength, because we had the length of the tube. If you have the length of the tube, predict that you're going to have to be doing this sort of calculation. And then the other math was easy, right? This is just V equals lambda F. Pretty straightforward formulas there. It just might have slipped your mind that you needed to use this formula here. If you see length, you're probably gonna have to figure out wavelength using this setup here. Okay, so that's all for number one. Pretty straightforward if you just thought of the right path that you needed to do. So I'll erase this, and we move on to number two, which has this little table. It says, in an experiment, a tubular musical instrument is played such that sustaining waves are established inside of the tube. A student is provided with the data shown in the table, which contains information about the length of the tube and the fundamental frequency. This is all set up, right? It says the speed of the sound in the air is considered to be 340. So I'll write that here. Speed is equal to 340 meters per second. Which of the following statements is correct about the type of tube used in the experiment? So it gives us the options here, right? Open, open, close, closed, open, and then we don't know. so we're basically doing what we did in the previous problem, right? We've got length information, and we've got speed here, and we're checking it basically against the fundamental frequency. Because depending on the type of tube it is, right, that length to wavelength relationship could change. Now, having said that, right, where we're going to take the length, we're going to figure out the wavelength, right, just like the previous problem, use speed to find frequency. If you're thinking about this, you might be thinking, hold on, in all of the previous sections we've done, open, open, and closed, closed have given us the same result. So if we use those relationships, right, where they both have the same formula, right, wavelength is 2 over n times L, if we use the same relationship here, shouldn't they be the same? If it's open, open, and closed, closed, wouldn't those both be the answer, right? How can we tell those apart? And you're actually really correct. So it can't be either or, right? It has to possibly be both, which isn't an option here, fun fact. You don't see that. So That should cue you in. Well, it's either clopen or it's we can't figure it out, because it can't be one open open or closed closed or the other. It has to be both, right? Because they're the same. They work the same way. So that'd be very astute of you if you were thinking about that. But I've gone off a little bit on a tangent. So we'll get back to the problem and I'll show you how to solve. So we've got length information. And we basically use the same setup we did in the previous problem to check and see about the fundamental frequency, right? Because our frequency is going to change depending on what wavelength we get, using the wavelength to length of the tube relationship. So since we have thought ahead and think, oh, well, it can't be open, open, and not be closed, closed, so it's probably clopen or we don't know, we'll start with the clopen, actually, because I think that's a good way to make yourself do a little bit less work. So what we're going to do is we need to take that length of the tube and figure out the wavelength. So we're doing fundamental frequency, right? So recall that our wavelength relationship, wavelength is equal to, for Clopin, it's equal to 4 divided by N times L, right? So, but this time we're using, it says fundamental frequency. So first harmonic meaning N equals 1. So we get lambda equals 4 times L. Great. So we're ready to find wavelength because we have L. We'll start at the top, which is L equals 0.1. So 4 times 0.1 meters, we get that wavelength equals 0.4 meters. And we have speed here, right? Speed is 340. And we can use that to find frequency, just like we did in the previous problem. Lambda times frequency. Speed is 340 meters per second. 0.4 meters times frequency, divide by 0.4. And it turns out that we do, in fact, get 850 hertz. Wow. Little preview. So we'd still be using, so the first one checks out. Now it would be recommended that you like double check that it works for the next ones, right? Because it looks like Clopin is working, but say if it didn't work for the next one, then we wouldn't know because it wouldn't be working out the way it's supposed to. But a little preview for it, I won't write it all out because it's really just changing the one number here, right? So this time, our relationship here is the same, but this time you're changing the length, so it's 0.17 now. So 4 times 0.17 is 0.68. So our wavelength would be 0.68. So then we plug in 0.68 here, right? So we'd do 340 divided by 0.68, and we would get 500. And it checks out also if you do the third one. So it turns out that it is Clopin. So C, it is closed open. But yeah, we basically just did the same setup here as the previous problem. You were just double checking against it. Now, to show you that it doesn't work for open-open or closed-closed, right? Our closed-closed relationship would be, or even open-open is the same, right? Would be lambda equals 2 divided by N times L, right? So for our first harmonic, it would be lambda equals 2 times L. So if it was 2 times 0.1, we'd get 0.2. And then 340 divided by 0.2 is equal to 1,700 hertz, which is obviously not the fundamental frequency that they got. So that is not working properly if you do it in that case. So yeah, turns out it's closed open and I can double check it against it not working for the others because this is the same formula for open open, right? So we checked closed closed, open open's the same. It's Clopin. Lovely. So those are questions that I were on here for examples, just to see me pulling in things from other places. But there's not a heavy emphasis on like these calculations specifically. The important things are that if you know that there's like the length change, right, changes the frequency because of that drawing that I made, and that whatever n harmonic it is, you take the fundamental times whatever number that is, right? 10 times the fundamental, 11 times the fundamental, whatever. Those are your big takeaways from this lesson. I just kind of wanted to show you things that you could do with all of the stuff that we learned here. So yeah, fill out that exit ticket and play your plastic straw instruments wearing your pink cowboy hat.